So this has really become a national priority in the U.S. And this is a report that was published from the White House in the 2011. And they call it the Materials Genome Initiative, okay? And people criticize the name. What they were trying to do was something similar to the genome program in the U.S. The genome program, the whole idea of the genome was to sequence the DNA for humans and see how many genes, you know, they found some 10,000, 12,000 genes in a typical chromosome. And then if you can identify the sequence of proteins, you can develop vaccines and all that. And they say, well, you know, if we could do the same for materials, if we could really build the building blocks for calculations, we should be able to come up with any material. And the whole idea of this is that if we continue doing materials research the way we do, it really takes a long time. You know, superconductivity, they discovered the high-temperature superconductors in the 1980s. To this day, we still have not commercialized them. There are some demonstration projects. Probably it's going to take another 10 years before they get commercialized. The gas turbines that we use today for transportation, you know, the alloys that are used there took like 30 years to develop. It really takes a long time to develop materials. But the whole idea is that if you can use the materials genome approach, you can get lots of materials with better properties in a very short period of time. So that's the whole goal, accelerate the discovery and innovation of materials. And they believe that the materials genome is going to do that. And it's not just thermoelectrics. So this is a plot for photovoltaic applications, okay? And what we have here is what? Where is this? Band gap, okay? So now you can calculate the band gap. You can get efficiency here predicted. Here is your band gap. And there are some materials that we use today. Let's see, these copper, indium, selenides. But there are lots of materials that haven't been synthesized, but now you can calculate, you can actually predict band gaps of materials from first principles. So here's where the theory guys come together again. You just put your molecule in the computer, let it run, do the energy calculations, and this will give you some of the properties for a band gap as a function of efficiency. What's interesting, again, and it's all about the electrons. I mean, look at all these elements repeat themselves, you know, selenium, tellurium, copper is up there. Copper provides a lot of electrons. That's why it's there. Sulfur. So now it's just the same materials over and over again. And the reason for that is because of the electrons, how the electrons are arranged in the atom. That explains why these materials appear over and over again in this type of applications. Yesterday, we talked about photoelectrochemical cells. And obviously, you know, we have been using titanium a lot. But the question is, are there materials other than titanium for these applications? And the answer is yes. You know, we can do the calculation. So this is a chart to screen just oxides and oxide nitride compounds. So this is a relatively narrow group of materials based on their photoelectrochemical response as a function of light absorption. So this is a chart where you can organize data. The nice thing about organizing data this way is that it catches your attention right away. If you use the colors, if you're looking for a particular band gap, you say, okay, we got to go there. And there are some similarities, you know, if you start looking at this titanium. This is why titanium is so good, because if you look at titanium, most of these compounds with titanium is going to give you the right answer. There may be some compounds that will not do anything. But that's the nice thing about these studies. And you can do these studies very fast for a lot of different combinations. So remember, this is why I had the picture of Edison. You know, Edison, if Edison had been alive today, he would probably go to the laboratory and, you know, make all these chemical compounds and go and test them. And he was great, you know. I mean, he's probably one of the greatest minds in the history of mankind, but that's the way he used to do science doesn't apply today. Today we use computers, And the nice thing about this approach is that you can do screening, and that's why we call it a screening, of thousands and thousands and thousands of compounds, okay? And every time these models get more and more complicated, here we have binary compounds, but pretty soon you can start looking at ternary compounds, quaternary compounds, and so forth. So, we didn't talk about batteries this week, but we discussed batteries at one point. Remember the five things that we investigate for batteries? Safety, energy density, power density, cost, durability, okay? So here we have a group of people from MIT. This is Professor Cedar, where they look at lithium-ion batteries. And the way a lithium-ion battery works is fairly simple. You have an anode, you have a cathode, and it is a diffusion of lithium ions between the electrodes through a membrane and a liquid electrolyte, what provides the flow of electricity in these batteries. As I told you, safety is a big issue. This is a picture of a Tesla. This was actually very unfortunate. I give Tesla a lot of credit. This company, I mean, they're great. The owner of the company is a fellow named Elon Musk, and the guy is the owner of SpaceX, so they are sending rockets to the International Space Station. He's building a battery for home. I don't know if you saw the announcement a few days ago. So you can buy batteries, $3,000 batteries, to store energy at home. He's building a factory in Nevada for his Tesla automobiles. And this was a freak accident. There was a piece of metal on the road that somehow got propelled and punctured the battery, and they had this accident. And this is the last thing you want to have. If you're a maker of batteries or automobiles, this is the last thing you want to see. And this was actually in every newspaper in the U.S. The stock price for Tesla dropped that day. It was bad for business. I mean, they lost a lot of money. But they reacted. They made a titanium plate. That was a quick and dirty solution. They put a titanium plate on the batteries to prevent this from happening. But most importantly, the question that they are asking today is, you know, can we do chemistries? Can we do chemistries that will be safer, that even if we have an accident like this, they will not result in explosion? And that's precisely what the group at MIT has been doing. So here we have a chart where you look at the electrochemical potential for many different batteries. If you are in this range, you have less safety. These chemistries are prone to ignite. If you move in this direction, they are more safe. And this is just data from calculations using first principles. So you do the quantum mechanics calculations, and now you can predict the type of voltages and electropotentials that you will get in your battery. And now you can start selecting whether there are sulfates, oxides, phosphates, borates, or silicates, the type of chemistries that are going to give you the safety that you need to prevent an explosion in the battery, okay? That's the power of theory. We can predict these things from first principles. We have access to supercomputers, and we do the calculations. So it's another example of cathodes for lithium-ion batteries. There was a company in the U.S. called A123. Unfortunately, they went bankrupt. But they were commercializing these iron phosphates for lithium-ion batteries. So, you know, all these calculations are usually applied to these fancy materials, photovoltaics, thermoelectrics, batteries, photocatalysis. But people are also looking at structural materials and the idea of designing new materials using computers. One of the alloys that we are very interested in is magnesium. You know, magnesium is a very light alloy. It has a very low density, and therefore it's attractive for structural applications in transportation. The problem with magnesium is that its creep resistance at room temperature is not very good. It doesn't have a lot of ductility. You know, magnesium has an HCP structure, a hexagonal. It's very difficult for these locations to move in magnesium. But the idea of this approach is to find alloying elements that you could combine with magnesium to improve its formability. So it's an example of how, using first principle calculations, you can actually determine what type of alloying elements you should use to design magnesium alloys with better mechanical properties. So, again, these calculations apply not just for functional materials, but also for structural materials. And the idea is that using this integrated computational materials engineering, you could go from the electronic structure through different length scales all the way to design engine blocks or chassis for automobiles. This is another example of how people have used this approach for aluminum alloys. The idea is that now people want to make engine blocks out of aluminum. Obviously, you want to make sure that that you have good mechanical properties. So this is an example of comparing predictions of this should be yield strength. Yeah, this is yield strength. This is what the models predict. This is what the experimental measurements show. And you can see that the models are actually very good, you know. The models are actually very good. So this is good news. The other good news about this is that if you don't want to do theory, if you want to do experimental work, you still will have a job in the future because, you know, somebody has to prove and verify that these predictions have to be correct. So all of some of us who do experimental work are going to be employed. Somebody has to verify these predictions. Now, the only difference is that instead of making 1,000 tests, we probably have to do 10 tests and then just make sure that the predictions are right where they should be. This is the paper I'm going to give you, Jose Ignacio. In fact, this is on the web. I was telling Jose Ignacio that this group, there's a collaboration between Berkeley and MIT, and they are publishing databases with thousands and thousands of compounds, elastic properties, heats of formation, electrochemical potentials, band gaps, I mean, just name it, magnetic properties. And again, everything is predicted from theory, including these elastic properties. And this should not be surprising because elastic properties are the result of how atoms interact. If you think of atoms connected by springs, you know, that's really the most fundamental interpretation of Young's modulus. And now with computers, we can do this, and that can be very effective. In fact, this is a plot showing calculations for different compounds and elements. This is the bulk modulus versus shear modulus. So this is all the class of materials that they have calculated in this table. For a material that is isotropic, you know, you only need two elastic constants. It can be bulk and shear moduli. If you know this, you can calculate Poisson's ratio. So the Poisson's ratio is shown here with this color. And the Poisson's ratio is actually a very interesting indicator of ductility in many materials. And so people continue finding important implications from these values. For most metals, you know, Poisson's ratio is about 0.3. That's the average value that we assume for most metals. The maximum value you can assume is 0.5 for an incompressible material. But you can have very small Poisson's ratio, and this is a collection of data that shows you that there are compounds out of beryllium, for example, that have very small Poisson's ratios. But again, this is all theory. And then when you compare those calculated values of bulk modulus and you compare them with actual measurements, you know, the correlations are pretty good. You know, this is good news. This is good news. All this computing power that we have actually is giving us the right answer. And again, the big development was that the theory guys were always behind the experimentalists. Now the theory guys are ahead of the experimentalists. And that's good because, you know, we cannot afford the Edisonian approach. We now have to rely on computers to do lots of experiments. Okay, before we go to the next and last section, any questions? No? Are you guys impressed with theory? Did you suspect that theory could do so much? No? You know, we used to make fun of the theory guys, they were like second-class citizens a few years ago, you know. If you were a theory guy, cambiamos el. Yeah, in the old days, Everybody poo-poo the theory guys. You know, if you were a theory guy, you were second class citizen. Now these guys, they got all the money for the computers. They get all the credit. You see that group from MIT and in Berkeley, they're publishing all this data. So, you know what I'm saying? Claro. Yeah, and that's the other thing that you can do. You can create your phase diagrams out of this principle. So, so you can look at solubility and new phases, metastable phases. I mean, this is powerful. I mean, I think about it, and you know, when I started the. Okay. Okay. So let's. Any questions about the theory? Any questions? You know, and this is just the surface. I mean, there is so much underneath. But this is powerful stuff. This is really powerful stuff. Okay. When we talk about efficiency. We talk about thermoelectrics, but there are some other areas where we spend a lot of energy. And one area where we spend a lot of energy is in buildings. And you know, sometimes I remember when I was in graduate school, people wanted to work on projects that were sexy, you know. So when I was a student, ceramic matrix composites was one of the hot topics. So everybody wanted to work on ceramic matrix composites. And then came nanotechnology, so everybody wanted to work on nanotubes and fullerenes and graphene. You know, they always want to have this type of product. Nobody wants to work on cement. You know, nobody wants to work on steel. And but what's interesting is that in the case of steel, you know, steel was one of those very topics. If you were doing your PhD thesis on the steel, you were boring and you know. So. But now we have all these advanced steels, you know, high-strength steels, trip steels, and they have really revolutionized the auto industry. If you look at all these new structures for automobiles, it's all high-strength steel, and they have shaved, you know, 200 pounds out of the weight of a structure. And it's all because of a good understanding of metallurgy. Talk about phase diagrams, TTT, time-temperature transformations, thermomechanical treatments, precipitation, phase transformations. I mean, all of that heavy-duty material science, metallurgy came together, and they developed some incredible results. I predict that construction materials is going to become sexy in the future. And for example, we were talking about phase change materials yesterday. You know, very soon we're going to be designing walls and roofs that have these phase change materials that are going to be very energy efficient. Now, the challenge is cost still, you know, it's cost, because construction materials are there cheap. This morning we were talking about putting nanotubes in concrete. It's very expensive. But once you show the benefit, in particular from an energy perspective, that you can reduce the heating or the cooling cost of a building by using better insulation, you know, people will think about it and say, oh, yeah, it makes sense to make an initial investment, because over the life of the building we're going to save a lot of money. So one area where we are seeing a lot of work is in insulation, especially with these phase change materials. These phase change materials take advantage of the latent heat of fusion as a way to store or release energy depending on the conditions. And one of the challenges from the materials science perspective is, how do you encapsulate these things? You don't want them to be melting inside the walls. So what you do is you encapsulate them in little containers. They are distributed on the walls. But that's a nice materials engineering problem to have. Obviously, with the geothermal, you know, we should take advantage of heat stored in the ground. So having all these systems to run coolants through the house and through the ground, that will give us an edge. So there's going to be a lot of work on building materials, and I think the payoff is going to be great. In fact, somebody with a good idea could become a millionaire. You know, you have a good idea that is inexpensive for insulations, you're really going to change the world. Lighting, that's where we probably have seen incredible changes. I told you the story of the incandescent lamp in the U.S. People, there are some people who still want to live with incandescent lamps. Compact fluorescents were very strong, and I think they are on their way out. This is interesting. You know, people thought that this was going to be the technology for many years. people were concerned with mercury because there's a little bit of mercury in these lamps. But what's going to happen is that now we have solid state lighting, all these different LEDs. So what we have here is a chart that shows you luminous performance as a function of time, and really what changed the world was the invention of the blue LED. And because of the blue LED, we could have white LED. So white LED was only possible once we had the blue LED available. But this also compares the various lamps. This is the reason why we use low pressure sodium in cities. And this shows you the different types of lamps. Here is Edison's first light bulb in terms of luminous performance, obviously a very inefficient lamp. And you see LEDs everywhere, traffic signals. If you go to Las Vegas, now everything is LEDs. And because of the blue LED, we have now white LEDs. And this is Tsuji Nakamura. He got the Nobel Prize in Physics just a couple of years ago for coming up with the blue laser. So solid state lighting, that's an area where we have seen significant developments. And guess what? It's all about quantum mechanics, you know? It's a p-n junction, just like a photocell. You're actually providing energy, and you're emitting photons as a result of passing an electric current, okay? So this is another example of how quantum mechanics has really come to make a change. Another area where we don't talk about, because again, it's not sexy, is the area of the grid. And this is a cover of Time magazine in the US. We had a major blackout in the Northeast a few years ago. And this happened when one of these high voltage transmission lines fell because of a tree. And it just triggered a chain reaction, and the whole Northeast in the US went through a blackout. So this is an area where there is a lot of good engineering possible. These cables get very hot. When you pass current through these cables, they get hot. And when they get hot, they start sagging, okay? The hotter they get, the more sagging. And then if there are trees near the cables, they can get entangled and they can rupture. So one area where composites have actually found an application is in these lines. So it's an example of how people are using now composite materials to carry all of the mechanical loads in these cables. If you buy a cable today, inside the cable you're going to find steel. There are going to be some steel wires. This is all aluminum. So 90% of the current in these cables flows through the aluminum skin, and then the steel core carries all the mechanical loads, okay? They also carry some electricity, but it's mainly for structural purposes. Now with composites, they are so light and they are so stiff that sagging is no longer a problem, okay? So it's an application of composites. One of the challenges is how do you join these cables? And this is the problem with composites. You know, composites are very strong, they are very stiff, but it's not easy to go through plastic deformation. I mean, the way these cables are connected is through a process called crimping, where you can induce a lot of plastic deformation and then you join the cables. With composites, you cannot do that. If you try to do that with a composite, you're gonna break it, okay? So trying to develop adhesives that will connect these composite strands is a challenge. These cables can get fairly hot, can reach 100 degrees C easily. So for an adhesive, that's going to be a problem. So this is a good materials engineering problem. This is a good example of how we use composites for this application to make these cables less sagging. And something that I believe we will see in the near future is going to be superconducting cables. This is what a superconductive cable looks like. That gives you an idea. If you look at the cross-section of the superconductor, it's actually a tape. Where the superconducting phase is just a small volume fraction of the whole thing, and the challenge is how do you make this structure to be reliable. Obviously, you have to cool down the superconductor. That's why you have such a complex structure. But I hope that one day, you know, we're going to start replacing all these transmission lines with superconducting cables, and that's going to reduce electrical losses and improve improve efficiency. So that's an area where we shouldn't lose perspective. This is actually very important. The last topic I want to talk about is gas turbines, and this is a schematic of a gas turbine made by General Electric. We were very excited because this turbine, running this location, has started using ceramic matrix composites. Okay, so when I was doing my dissertation, I was working on ceramic matrix composites. If you remember, my research was funded by DARPA, okay, and those materials have actually been used in military engines. Okay, so we have used those materials in military engines for a number of years, but this is the first time that those materials are going to be used in civilian aircraft. So very soon, later this year, they're going to have the first flight. You're going to have ceramic components inside gas turbines. I mean, this is incredible. And then GE has made an announcement that in the not-so-distant future, at least for the first two stages of the turbine, they're going to start making some of these components out of ceramic matrix composites also, okay? Now, why is this important? Because you can operate at higher temperatures. And if you look at thermodynamics, it tells you that the higher your temperature difference between the hot and the cold reservoir, the higher the efficiency. So this is an example of how material science and engineering is driving development. Today, these components are heavily engineered. They use single crystals of nickel-based superalloys. Some of them have to be cooled internally. They actually use steam to cool them to prevent them from melting. And then on the surface, they use a ceramic coating. It's called a thermal barrier coating. And the idea of the thermal barrier coating is that it's going to reduce the temperature from the hot surface to the inside because they want to have low thermal conductivity. So what's interesting about this is that when you talk to the physicists, you know, the physicists are very interested with electrons. So we talk about thermoelectrics. We want to lower thermal conductivity. If you talk to an engineer working on gas turbines, he also wants to lower thermal conductivity. They would like to make thermal barrier coatings that are almost zero thermal conductivity to really insulate the metallic pieces. So the same type of discussions with phonons, macrostructural engineering, porosity, grain boundaries, second phases, everything about increasing phonon scattering is the same conversation that we had with people doing thermal barrier coatings. It is exactly the same problem. Now, the material that is used mostly for these systems is zirconium oxide, zirconia. And zirconia is a very interesting material. It goes through various phase transformations. And those phase transformations come with very large volumetric changes, which could destroy the material. So we actually use yttrium oxide to stabilize one of the phases of the zirconia to prevent these phase transformations. And most people today use a zirconia thermal barrier coatings for the first stages in these gas turbines, okay? And they are very effective. I mean, they may be like a millimeter, 2 millimeters, 3 millimeters in thickness, but they can knock down the temperature sufficiently so that we can operate with these metallic components. Now, when we go to ceramic matrix composites, then we will no longer need thermal barrier coatings because this material should take the heat fairly well. So this is going to be a major development. One area where we are concerned with ceramic matrix composites is that every time you burn natural gas, you're going to have water. Water is a byproduct of combustion. And water reacts with materials like silicon carbide and silicon nitride. So something that is very interesting, it was actually counterintuitive, but people are developing something called environmental barrier coatings for ceramic blades for these gas turbines, okay? And the idea of these environmental barrier coatings is to protect materials like silicon carbide and silicon nitride from water vapor. Water vapor is a very aggressive element. It can literally destroy materials. And the way it does it is for something called active oxidation. Water vapor can really destroy silicon carbide and silicon nitride, which are the materials that we use for these ceramic matrix composites. So if you look at this region right here, this is where the combustors are. Here is where the combustion process takes place. the hot gases come rushing through the shroud, and here's where the first stage of the turbine is, and these components are now made out of a ceramic matrix composite. It's silicon carbide fibers in a silicon carbide matrix, and this is actually very rewarding, because these are materials that we work with when I was in school, and then later on at the Oak Ridge National Lab. And now, you know, you can, if you fly with your wife, you can say, you know, I actually have something to do with the materials in that turbine, you know, when you're flying over the Pacific Ocean. So this is very exciting. And again, it took almost 30 years. This is how much time it takes from the moment you start developing materials to the moment they come into service. And this is why the Materials Genome Initiative is so important. We want to shorten that period of time from 30 years, hopefully down to 10 years, where you can do all the certification, all the testing. But you don't have to do the Edisonian part, where you are really looking for a lot of things. Let the computers do that. You shorten the time. And once you know you have the right material, you go and make it, and then test it and make your components. The other important development here, this is a composite. These are carbon fibers in a polymeric matrix. But this is the blade of the fan, OK? And these fans are actually an integral component. These machines are called bypass fan turbines. And there is a lot of thrust that is generated by these fans. And the motion of these fans propels air in this direction. And a lot of this air doesn't go through the turbine. And that actually contributes to the thrust of the machine. It's actually a significant part. And the only way you can do that is if you have materials that are very strong, can be made in a fairly large size, and that's where your composites come into the picture. So this is a polymer matrix composite. You can see here the complex shape of these blades. But it is these blades that has given these turbines an incredible amount of efficiency. So these blades are, at room temperature, they are going to be working from minus 20 degrees C, especially if you are way up there at 30,000 feet, up to 100 degrees centigrade. That's usually the range. The hot temperatures are right here. So what you have is you have air going here. Some of the air bypasses the turbine, but contributes to the thrust, which is good. And then some of the air goes through the compressor. The air gets compressed. Then the air gets mixed with the fuel here, gets ignited, goes through the turbine, and the rest of the thrust comes out of the turbine. So these don't see a lot of temperature. What you need here is a lot of structural integrity. And the other thing about this foreign object impact, these are made in a way that they can survive the impact of a bird. And what they do, this is gross, but when they certify these engines, what they do, they go to the supermarket and they buy chickens. And they put them in a cannon and they shoot the chicken against the blade. And the blade is rotating and it has to survive. If it passes the test, then they can fly. So this is an actual certification test from the FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration in the US. So at the end of the test, you have a lot of blood and feathers, but that's how they test these blades to survive impacts. Okay,